Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Off-Centered Leadership, the Dogfish Head Guide to Motivation, Collaboration, and Smart Growth by Sam Calagione. Narrated by Brian Troxell. Publisher's note, this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material.
For me, art that's alive and urgent is art that's about what it is to be a human being. And whether one is a human being in times of enormous profundity and depth and challenge, or one is trying to be a human being in times that appear to be shallow and commercial and materialistic, really isn't all that relevant to the deeper project. The deeper project is, what is it to be human? David Foster Wallace. Introduction. But yield who will to their separation. My object in living is to unite my avocation and my vocation, as my two eyes make one in sight. Only where love and need are one, and the work is play for mortal stakes, is the deed ever really done, for heaven and the future's sakes. Robert Frost, Two Tramps in Mud Time. Sitting in the driver's seat of my new, used muscle car, paintbrush in hand, the sound of the throaty engine music to my ears, I began painting the words, go slowly, go thoughtfully, in bright red acrylic paint on the center of my steering wheel. Enjoy the journey. Just before I turned 46, my grandmother Jessie passed away at the glorious age of 96. She had run a small business with her husband, Sam, and had been a great inspiration to me. As I thought about her life, I figured if my grandmother lived to the age of 96, then it was certainly reasonable to assume I could live to be, say, 92 if I started taking better care of myself, stopped stressing out so much, and stopped trying to do so many new things so quickly. So I decided to treat my 46th birthday as my definitive midlife moment, the unofficial halfway mark of my journey along this mortal coil, and celebrate this existential milestone memorably with gusto. I traded in my sensible used Volvo sedan for a 500-horsepower 3-year-old Dodge Challenger Super B. This isn't just any muscle car. It's the newer iteration of my boyhood dream car that I have thought about since I was a 6-year-old doodling the earlier model upon my grade school textbooks back in the late 1970s. I bought the car on my 46th birthday, and within just 2 months had to bring it in for service twice. The mechanic explained that the car's big-ass engine, mechanic's term originally, now mine as well, needed more time to warm up than normal, much smaller engines do. I couldn't just jam the car into drive and peel out. Hence the go slowly reminder. And the go thoughtfully part is to remind me not to check my phone for any reason while driving. To focus on the present, the task at hand, and to enjoy the journey. This reminder, to go slowly and go thoughtfully, now emblazoned on my steering wheel, has also become the mantra for the thoroughly enjoyable, illuminating, and challenging personal and vocational midlife crossroads I find myself navigating. Like my engine, I am warming up to the notion that I can't move as fast and take as many risks with myself or my company as I did a couple of decades ago when we were both much younger. Celebrating the epiphany. Within a few weeks of my birthday, Dogfish Head celebrated a milestone as well, our 20th anniversary as the first brew pub in the first state. I figured if I were going to treat 46 as a halfway point in my personal life, it would also make sense, at least to me, to treat the 20th anniversary of the company I founded as the halfway mark of my role within this company. Thus, I reasoned, Dogfish Head would be the only company I would ever work for. Why? Because I love what I do, and I love the people I have gotten to know as coworkers and beer lovers throughout the 2 decades of my entrepreneurial journey. But I also realized that to be the most beneficial to the company, my role at Dogfish Head over the next 20 years needed to be different than the type of work I did during the first 20 years. In a word, I needed to evolve. The work priorities and habits I had relied on in those first 20 years could not sustainably remain the same for the next 20. To commemorate, capture, and internalize this epiphany, I got a tattoo. Joining the fans. Like the famous line spoken by Blanche DuBois in the play A Streetcar Named Desire, I have always depended on the kindness of strangers. At the heart of Dogfish Head's exploration of goodness is our off-centered version of the Golden Rule. Always aspire to do for others as you would want others to do for you. With the help of hundreds of amazing, talented coworkers, past and present, we have succeeded in building a company focused on producing the types of beers, spirits, food, events, and spaces that we envisioned other creative, adventurous, rebellious people would want to experience, engage with, and rally around. And rally they have. Dogfish started out as the smallest brewing operation in America and is now the 13th largest craft brewery out of over 4,000. Through the years, I have met, personally thanked, and high-fived tens of thousands of hardcore Dogfish fans who have acted as our evangelists, introducing their friends to our beers and helping us grow. Some of these evangelists are so passionate about Dogfish Head that they literally bled for us, tattooing various regions of their bodies with our brand to make it part of their permanent selves. When people would show me their tats or ask to take photos with me as they flashed their tattoos to the camera, I felt both pride and gratitude. Over time, though, as I met more and more of these bold and inked Dogfish evangelists, a third emotion would creep in: guilt. If these people cared enough about what Dogfish stands for to literally brand themselves, the least I could do was to join them in solidarity. After all, I first sketched the Dogfish, Shark, and Broken Shield logo nearly 22 years ago when writing my business plan, and I have been thinking about it and obsessing about its place in the world pretty much every day since. So now I am a 46-year-old entrepreneur with a new tattoo and a used muscle car, who sometimes peels out at stop signs, but doesn't break speed limits as often as he used to when he drove the more sensible Volvo. To her immense credit, my erratic driving habits embarrass my wife, Mariah, more than the muscle car or the tattoo. I have taken to wearing a mullet wig on the rare occasions she accompanies me in my car, under the pretense that I think she might be less mortified if pedestrians and other drivers in our small town don't recognize that the crazy driver she is riding with is her husband. It goes without saying that Mariah's sense of humor and patience with my shenanigans, starting when we began dating in high school in the mid-80s, remains unflappable. Admittedly, my tat is less ornate and bold than some others I've admired, but it's pretty much identical to the sketch I first drew 22 years ago. But it's facing the wrong way, I can almost hear you saying, if you are familiar with our logo. Nope. The image of my tattoo did not get reversed in the design phase of this book. I purposely decided to have the shark and the shield face outward on my forearm instead of inward, as it would were it a faithful representation of our company logo. Proceed slowly, go thoughtfully. So, this is how getting a tattoo, the second notable moment in my most excellent midlife crossroads, ties so directly to the first notable moment of buying that used muscle car. To use a vehicular analogy, when Dogfish opened, we were sort of like a 50cc dirt bike. Simple, nimble, thrilling, and powered by a very small engine. Instead of horsepower, we originally ran on about 20 manpower, if you consider our payroll the year we opened. We could bet the farm at every turn and make split-second spontaneous decisions and whimsical choices. We could all keep aware and in tune with each change of direction because all of us experienced these zigs and zags together in the same single building, the brew pub in Rehoboth Beach, where we brewed and sold our beers and cooked and sold our food. You can risk a lot more when you have very little in totality to put at risk. Today, this company, which began pretty much as my company out of my imagination, has grown into our company. 230 of us and counting. And our company needs to run a lot more like a very powerful, very intricate muscle car than a frisky little dirt bike. We need to grow more slowly, and we need to go more thoughtfully. In the last few years, we have prioritized strong growth over fast growth. We have embraced this strategy in order to carefully expand all the key components of our company in harmony: personnel, equipment, and resources. Going slowly still means going forward. Going forward means growing. And growing thoughtfully means a shift in thinking and acting at Dogfish that needs to begin with me. It begins with me, but it takes a village. This is not my leadership book. The biggest reason our company has been successful is because we have created a community of co-workers that champions strong leadership coming from many talented people within our organization. This is their book as much as it is mine. I am just telling our story. Of course, it is from my perspective, but I am hopeful that the respect I have for each of their perspectives and inputs on our journey comes through. As the leaders of Dogfish Head, over the course of 20 years, we have mostly been aligned on where the company is heading and how we will get there. Mostly, but not always. I used to thrill in taking unplanned risks, abruptly zigging the handlebars of my dirt bike to the left when everyone, both inside and outside the company, would expect me to turn to the right. I would be thrilled when the almost out of gas dashboard light would come on and my adrenaline would pump as I sped down the road without knowing if I would make it to the next fuel stop. None of that mattered because I so zealously enjoyed the risk-soaked ride. Today, at the center of my own journey, at this midpoint in my personal and professional life, I am embracing the need for me and for our company to enter a new phase and proceed slowly. This evolution will occur in different ways for different coworkers, but for me, it means to not act quickly or rashly, to live in the present, here and now, to go deep into the moment and not spend quite so much of my time thinking about the future. Go thoughtfully is a good working mantra as I embark on this next phase of my professional and personal journey. To think before I act, to recognize, embrace, and encourage the creative input and thoughtfulness of all my co-workers and fellow leaders at Dogfish Head. To think less about my own personal gratification in unilaterally deciding creative and strategic direction, and think more about collaboratively blending together the creativity and enthusiasm of the great people helping me run this company to decide those things. Making all this happen will certainly be challenging, but the end game is clear. I want Dogfish to not always require my daily involvement in its running. I want the company that I started to outlive me. In retrospect, I now see that in certain ways, I spent the first 20 years of my career, for better and for worse, directing Dogfish Head as my own creative cathartic recreation center. I have always acknowledged, and I truly appreciate, the incredible contributions co-workers have made to the construction and expansion of this playground. But old habits die hard. I had to be selfish in leading Dogfish when it was tiny, because its potential existed more in my head than in the marketplace. In many ways, Dogfish Head has been the physical embodiment of my imagination, which is why I internalized so much of what I loved about the company and was reluctant to collaborate internally on big-picture strategy for so many years. This is no longer necessary. It's also no longer what is best for Dogfish Head if it is to continue growing, slowly and thoughtfully, in a direction that is best for the company and that allows Dogfish to have a life that is longer than my own. Remember, I am pretty sure I am only going to be around for exactly 46 more years. Now that Dogfish Head has evolved into a 230-manpower sizable machine with a big-ass engine that needs time to warm up, I am learning many things in all aspects of life, as an entrepreneur, as a father and a husband, as a flawed but committed to continue learning leader. My hope in writing this book is that many of the lessons I am learning will be useful to others facing similar challenges on their own business and leadership journeys. The narrative of this book is more of a movable feast than the first book I wrote about my entrepreneurial journey at Dogfish Head, Brewing Up a Business. For this book, I wanted to incorporate the others who have joined me on the leadership journey within our company, like my wife, Mariah, and our CEO, Nick Benz. I also chose to include sage business and creative advice from mentors and inspiring people who don't work at our company, but with whom I have forged meaningful friendships, like Nick Brayton, president of Woolrich, and the musician and actor Will Oldham. I spent a lot of writing time for this book on the road, while I was doing events and collaborative projects with many of the folks I interviewed for this book. I have written before about the importance of roaming the marketplace to get a deeper perception of your brand and your own business journey, and I have done that continually during the time I have worked on this book. As the graphic designer and professor Natalie Davis puts it in her fine essay, Sweat Equity, seek your inspiration in unexpected places. Expand beyond the web for research and get out in the world, to a bookstore, library, or theater. Follow other passions you have put aside too soon. Go to the ballet, borrow your younger sister's graphic novels, and volunteer at the food bank. Take a road trip and bring along a camera and your sketchbook. Expand your life experiences and the circle of people you interact with day to day, and your work will become richer and deeper in meaning. This has been true for me as my work at the company I started has continued to evolve. My role is changing. I intend to spend more of my time externalizing and sharing the creative and strategic opportunities that we, as a team, collaboratively conceive and develop together. All 230, and growing, of us are working together to grow Dogfish Head in the right direction. I am trying to look up and look out for the best ideas instead of looking too much within, which gets me back to my midlife tattoo. As I mentioned, the shark and shield logo on my arm faces out. If I did the tattoo accurate to our logo, it would face in. It's facing out to remind me that I must do so as well. A third way forward. I opened this introduction with an excerpt of a poem from one of my favorite writers, Robert Frost. When I rediscovered this particular poem a while ago, it immediately reminded me of the happy predicament I now find myself in at Dogfish Head. While I personally enjoy creative chaos and adventurous experimentation as key components at the heart of our brand, I now know that what is best for Dogfish is for me to spend more of my time helping my coworkers organize and amplify the products and projects we have already embarked on, and less of my time dreaming about new products and projects. When you read the passage of Frost's poem, you see it's evocative and sounds conversational, anecdotal, and relaxed from the outside looking in. But from the inside looking out, it's a very complex and organized piece of art built on an organized foundation of tightly rhymed iambic tetrameter lines. I see that the contrast between external perception and internal structure is very similar to our current reality at Dogfish. It works well for us that externally, Dogfish is perceived as a fun-loving, informal, experimental, whimsical company. We can be all of those things, but internally, we must be focused, organized, and working from a shared and well-communicated plan if we are going to execute to the highest level of our potential. In the poem, it appears that two tramps are confronting Frost the writer and the axe wielder with an ethical binary choice. He can either let them chop his wood, they need the work and the pay, or he can continue chopping himself because he enjoys the task and finds it personally rewarding. Doing something you love as your livelihood is what I think he means when he writes about making his vocation his avocation. As I read this poem, though, I can see another way forward between the lines. Frost didn't put it on the page, and I don't know if he would approve of my suggestion, but what if the narrator attempted to create a happy medium? Instead of handing his axe over to the two tramps, what if he got them their own axes? described to them their goal in terms of number of logs split in a certain amount of time? What if he let them use their own technique and style while still sharing what he had learned from his own experiences? And what if he continued to chop away alongside them because it brings him joy? Could this collaborative approach be even more satisfying than doing what you love to do alone? I am ready to find out if this third way forward can work for me, for my fellow leaders, and for the company. Chapter 1. From Entrepreneur to Leader. Since the day Dogfish Head started back in 1995, we've been lucky. That's not to say that we haven't worked hard for our success, or that we haven't had to learn to roll with some punches. All in all, though, a lot of good things keep happening to Dogfish Head. We try to do good things every day. I used to believe you make your own luck. I now think that is only partially true. Karma is a close relative to luck. And as Joseph Conrad said, it is the mark of an inexperienced man not to believe in luck. Within the first year of launching the company, we had a consistent positive cash flow to build on at our original brew pub. Few entrepreneurs can say that. What's more, we achieved this early success in the particularly brutal world of the restaurant industry, where most new establishments don't survive past their third year. The company opened up as Dogfish Head Brewings and Eats, a pub in Rehoboth Beach, Delaware, where we brewed and sold our beer. The decision to launch as a brew pub, a brewery business within a restaurant, was a gamble, but I figured that I could reduce the risk of the brewery failing by supplementing it with revenue from the restaurant. That proved to be a good bet, but it was never a sure thing. When I say lucky, though, I'm not talking about monetary good fortune. As I mentioned previously, being lucky to me means being well served by good karma, which is something we consciously try to cultivate. The hallmark of our culture, what I'm constantly emphasizing with our coworkers, is that Dogfish Head is not a company that sells beer, or food, or whatever, but rather is a company that creates high-quality, valuable, innovative experiences based on fairness and respect for our customers and community. This is our exploration of goodness. From day one, my main goal was to satisfy beer drinkers like me, eager for an experience much more flavorful, adventurous, and satisfying than the corporate industrial lager that dominated the landscape and consumer perception of American beer in the mid-90s. I went into business more with the idealism of an artist than with ambitious financial aspirations, so I like to think that this focus on creating positive energy, enriching people's lives by making unique, authentic, off-centered beer, was my prime motivation, not making money. Perhaps this sounds self-serving, but it's true. Money may be the fuel of a business, but at Dogfish Head, it's not our soul. We encourage free expression and nonconformity. Another reason so many of our most valuable coworkers have stayed at Dogfish Head is the generous compensation program we implemented even as we were just getting our feet under us. Sharing the fruits of success has been our priority since our earliest days. We have a great insurance package, including health and dental, a free case of beer for all brewery coworkers every paycheck, a weekly happy hour with complimentary beer and snacks for all coworkers and their families, and half-price food and drink for coworkers at our pub and brewery. The loyalties and talents of the people who have joined me to grow the company have played a tremendous role in our company's success. By the year 2000, we had become sufficiently established so that I no longer woke up each day wondering whether Dogfish Head was going to stay in business. There had been plenty of existential doubt before then, super stressful times when we revved hard on the revenue growth engine to buy additional equipment and brewing systems. I'd mask my concern during such moments with a confident game face and lead by example. "Sure, we're not perfect," I'd tell my coworkers, "but let's fix one small thing every day, try hard, fail forward, learn from each mistake, and we will be closer to perfect tomorrow than we are today." In the year 2000, the production brewery we built separate from our Rehoboth location became profitable in the same way the Brewings and Eats restaurant was from the start. Profitability in our business was meager early on, so I never take it for granted. Our brand has to stay relevant to our customers. Our products have to remain distinctive. But from that year forward, 5 years into the life of the company, I didn't have to worry about the cost side of the business. Other smart leaders at Dogfish keep costs under control, and I focus on creating new projects and products to increase revenue, competitive differentiation, and brand recognition. We remain a frugal company, as we have been since day one. A bootstrapping mentality is hardwired into our DNA, stemming from our entrepreneurial beginnings. We still approach every project and capital expenditure with an eye toward vetting efficiencies as if we were a startup. We're not trying to be cheap or beat up our vendors or pay less for something than it's worth, but when our business partners and our own coworkers see that we care about pennies, it makes them all sharpen their pencils. We are particularly careful and conscientious about the bidding process for our equipment and buildings. This is especially important in a bricks and mortar intensive business like brewing, where the physical capital to expand capacity infrastructure can cost millions of dollars each year. Creative freedom. Being freed from anxieties on the cost side allowed me the freedom to be creative. For the majority of my work hours, I was unleashed to do what I most love, come up with new ideas for Dogfish Head. My role as the founder, chairman, and majority vote holder made this creative freedom both a blessing and a curse for the company. I could launch an initiative pretty much on my own say-so, without first having to clear organizational hurdles or establish a comprehensive plan to move an idea forward. My personal vision drove our actions. Strategic choices shaping the future of Dogfish Head were preeminently, and almost exclusively, mine. From my perspective as an entrepreneur, that was the good news. The bad news, from the perspective of my coworkers, was that I was always having ideas. While often serving our goals, the result of my high-voltage energy pumping through the system could also, at times, be disruptive to the organization. As the boss, I would announce my latest business idea, and coworkers would have to switch gears and revise schedules to prioritize it. Nobody except Mariah felt empowered to resist. And I didn't always listen to her, or our CEO Nick Benz, or the rest of our leadership team when they would present resistance. After almost 2 decades of successful growth, I was convinced that this gut-oriented approach was for the best. Sometimes it was indeed for the best, as in the case of the Choc Lobster brew we released in 2012. A brew with cocoa nibs and lobsters, it originated as part of our program to make experimental one-off batches for our beer dinners. When I tasted it, paired with chocolate lobster bisque and a white truffle lobster salad slider at the dinner, I thought it was so terrific that we brewed a scaled-up batch to offer at the pub. When I proposed rolling it out commercially, everyone internally and externally insisted it would never sell, since we would have to charge so much more than the average keg price for a beer made with hundreds of pounds of lobster. I was sure the beer would be a success and rolled out production anyway. It turned out to be well received, winning a Great American Beer Festival silver medal. We went from brewing a few kegs at the pub to hundreds of kegs that we sell in states up and down the East Coast. In other instances, though, my next great thing ended up costing us time and money without much return. Like the combination see-through visor and baseball hat I designed. I figured this hat would play off our penchant for combining beers into a new style or beverage mashups, such as beer-wine hybrids like 61, which was conceived when I poured some red wine into a glass of 60-minute IPA, or our positive contact, a hybrid of beer and cider brewed with Fuji apples, roasted farro, cayenne pepper, and fresh cilantro. In this case, I wanted to do a mashup between a baseball cap and a sun visor, with the character of Paul Bunyan featured more prominently on that hat than our logo. We must have devoted the bulk of time in 4 2-hour marketing meetings over the course of several months to this project. Designers drew up a half dozen iterations, and 3 different prototypes were produced. I was confident that our customers, themselves being so off-centered and fearless, were going to love it. We stocked it at the shops in our restaurant and brewery, where it died on the shelves. It is still dying on our shelves, where you can buy one very reasonably at a deeply marked down sale price, or, if you prefer, for a nominal fee on eBay. Rather than worry about consequences of abrupt mid-course corrections, I prided myself on taking risks, learning quickly from our missteps, and changing course. Were Dogfish Head a conventional company, the seemingly erratic course I sometimes steered the organization on would not have been tolerated. But it was precisely this opportunity to boldly guide us into unexplored waters that I found so satisfying. The thrill I personally got from not knowing what would happen next was a powerful psychic reward. To me, this feeling was the essence of being an entrepreneur. That said, I am learning that being hooked on the adrenaline of uncertainty and directing a company unilaterally by improvisation are not the hallmarks of a great leader for a company of our scale. They are important traits for an entrepreneur to have, but they need to be tempered and honed as a company grows. Creative inspiration for me comes from traveling outside my comfort zone, outside of what I know in general life terms, and from a business perspective, outside of what already exists in our industry. I rely on this creative urge to push beyond limits when it comes to designing a new beer. As a result, we have not spent much time looking at consumer data or conventional tastes when we decide what beer to make next. Instead, our one fixed point of reference has been to seek out innovative, off-centered ways into new products and projects. As the person who fed those creative fires for the first 20 years, I got the most satisfaction roaming around far-flung fields that interested me. I am always on the lookout for ideas, seemingly unrelated to brewing, that can inform and complement our approach to what I like to call the soul of Dogfish. This is probably why, as we've evolved, we have become more than a beer company, and we do our work in many industries: food, spirits, clothes. Everything we do, making a pizza, designing a shirt, brewing a beer, informs everything else we do. Each business unit collaborates with and enhances the unique stature in the marketplace of the other business units. An apt way to capture our spirit of creative roaming is the quote from Moby Dick I had sewn on the collar of the shirts we do in collaboration with Woolrich, America's oldest outdoor clothing company. I am tormented with an everlasting itch for things remote. I love to sail forbidden seas and land on barbarous coasts. Your coworkers are your first responsibility. There is a term in Japanese for the ultimate expression of selfless appreciation and support: omotenashi. There is no direct translation in English, but the best definition might be something like, the host anticipates the needs of the guest in advance and offers a pleasant experience that guests don't expect. In the context of business, this can mean that the customer is always right. Or simply, that we want to exceed customer expectations in every way the customer interacts with our company and the things we make. I love the concept of omotenashi, but in my journey toward leadership, I give it a different twist. The customer is secondary. As a leader, your first responsibility is to your coworkers. You need to support them and help them to always try to do the right thing and to be as happy doing their work as possible. Going forward, I need to redirect more of my creative energy toward this end. I'm no Zen master, so there are going to be stumbles along the way. And I still intend to personally take the lead on some experimental brewing and arts projects that are dear to my heart, creatively cathartic, and marketable. Some of these projects may go into coast-to-coast distribution, and some experiments may be one-time-only, small-volume brews produced for events around our Delaware facility that allow me to interact with coworkers and Dogfish fans who come to visit us in our home state. But in terms of the evolving soul of Dogfish Head, my most important role is to be one among many who collectively make the important strategic and opportunity decisions facing the company. There will still be some specific functions attached to my job responsibility, particularly as majority owner, but a central component of my evolving role at Dogfish is to allow great ideas and great people to bubble up and contribute exponentially and collectively to the company we are growing together. With my transition in the company from single-minded entrepreneur to responsible leader, my creative approach similarly needs to change. I have to make sure the vast majority of product launches and innovation are no longer driven solely by my inspirations, but rather by the team's collective judgment of what's best for Dogfish Head. The best ideas and recommendations of my coworkers should be as important as mine in charting new directions. I fought this for years, fearing that I would get less personal satisfaction from helping other people realize their visions than I would from being the creator myself. It has taken me a while to get comfortable with this new approach. The first big step forward in my evolution came with experiencing satisfaction in external collaborations we undertook with bands and other breweries. I had to share creative authority in navigating these projects, and I found that not only did the project succeed, but I also had lots of fun learning from and working in tandem with the related external parties. The confidence I've drawn from those experiences has prepared me to collaborate better internally within our organization. I'm not naive about the difficulty in surrendering what was, before, my autonomous control. I have had to train my brain to recognize what I know and what I don't know, and focus alongside my fellow leaders on identifying the talented people who have great ideas at Dogfish Head, and empowering them to continue to develop and grow our business. My ongoing transition from an entrepreneur running a business to a leader inspiring a team has taken many years, lots of effort, and one particularly difficult company retreat. The Retreat, February 2014. It was a cold day on the Chesapeake Bay when we gathered in Cambridge, a beautiful Maryland colonial town first settled in the 1680s by English tobacco planters. We were pretty much the only off-season guests, gathered together at the beautiful waterfront resort for our annual management retreat. As I walked in, I could imagine what my coworkers on our leadership team were thinking. In recent years, there was a predictable pattern to these retreats, some small victories, and some growing frustrations. Every year, we would go on an off-site retreat that we would call a strategic retreat, but we would mostly just discuss and argue from our own perspective about the next year's brewery beer lineup and volume forecast. We would spend what was left of our time talking about how we should be better organized and how we desperately needed a longer-term strategy. Then I would get defensive, remind everyone of our track record of flying by the seat of our pants thus far, and say something like, "If we have a plan, we won't be spontaneous." It's true. I didn't like the concept of traditional multi-year strategic business plans. This year, though, at this annual strategic offsite meeting, I had made up my mind before we started that things needed to be different moving forward. The company had been steadily growing. This growth was rewarding and exhilarating, but it meant that running an increasingly large and complex group of businesses by intuition and spontaneity was no longer beneficial. In their end-of-year reviews, coworkers made it clear they needed me and our company's other leaders to communicate better. They wanted to be more involved earlier in the new products and projects we were launching. If we all participated in the conversations, they believed, the collective outcome would be that much richer. By discussing ideas together, everybody would have a much clearer vision of where we were going. In effect, they were asking me to be more accountable to them. I couldn't disagree with the merit of their arguments. I had always fought the standard corporate dogma that says a smart company has to develop a multi-year strategic plan through executive-level consensus and then stick to it. The problem I have is that the plan is typically based on research that projects the future based on the present and past dynamics within the industry according to a comprehensive review of where a company stands in comparison to its competitors. So you are often looking sideways or backward in this process instead of forward. Another recent experience primed me for change that day in 2014, an event that had occurred several months prior to the retreat. I was driving my second-hand Volvo with one of my best friends. The low fuel light flashed on the dashboard. I kept going and going. Finally, as we approached a service station, my buddy nervously asked whether I intended to stop. "Not yet," I answered. "I bet we can make the next one." I confess, I enjoy the unexpected when the gas light goes on. I like to see how far I can get on fumes. I've completely run out of gas a few times. Once, I had to literally coast the last quarter mile. No matter, I like tempting fate. On this occasion, though, I could see my friend was getting truly uncomfortable since there weren't many gas stations or houses or people along this particular road. He finally freaked out. "Dude, you aren't normal. This isn't fun." I was able to put myself in his seat and, riding on little more than fumes, pulled in at the next gas station. Afterward, I got to thinking about this episode and its relevance to Dogfish Head. Maybe, in the same way that I wasn't initially sympathetic to the anxiety I caused my friend that day in the car, I was similarly insensitive to the discomfort I was causing my coworkers in the way I steered our company. They had been expressing frustration at not having a strategic roadmap, but I consistently dismissed their plea for a strategic plan. The best thing that could happen to us would be that we get lost. This was my belief. The need to keep finding our own way would keep us open to opportunities other companies would not encounter and inspire us to be creative. We'd be blazing trails instead of staying on the safe, beaten path. What I hadn't been hearing, though, was the anxiety in their voices. They were basing their futures and the welfare of their families on the company. Dogfish Head was no longer just an entrepreneurial adventure for a few. It was now the livelihood of many. No wonder they were worried whenever they saw the company's fuel light go on. I wasn't completely oblivious to the effect my love of risk was having at Dogfish. There was mounting frustration throughout our leadership team, including my wife in some instances, with my management style of ready, fire, aim. Although I still believe in the improvisational philosophy of Black Mountain College and its mantra of "we shall see what we shall see," I understood that most of my coworkers and fellow leaders were looking for more focused direction. And I knew they were growing tired of my habit of continuously imposing my will for what we should do next, and my habit of being 99% sure about what would come after that, effectively leaving them without much space to make their own creative contributions to our agenda. I don't have a problem with plans per se, but I believe they need to be agile and flexible. A company's longish-term strategy should be based on a foundation of the competitive landscape of its industry and where the company stands within it. Context is everything. The plan has to be grounded in the culture of the company itself, its collective soul, before grounding it as a reaction to the competitive set. You can plan a path forward, but always with the proviso that things can quickly change and necessitate a different path. You've got to always be ready to move on. Personally, I don't particularly like paths. No surprise there to anybody who knows me. I truly believe that getting off paths is at the core of Dogfish DNA. It's what our products are all about. The quotation from Ralph Waldo Emerson that is our guiding principle, his prescription for how to pursue goodness, is an endorsement for blazing one's own trail. "Whoso would be a man must be a nonconformist. He who would gather immortal palms must not be hindered by the name of goodness, but must explore if it be goodness. Nothing is at last sacred but the integrity of your own mind." I knew that we were getting to a point in the company's life cycle where growing strong meant empowering others to lead with me. I recognized that the other people sitting at the leadership table were talented and motivated, yet another indication of the company's good luck, that we'd been able to attract such individuals. The moment had come for them to be able to contribute not only their operational and technical skills, but also their own creativity and opinions about our strategy. It wasn't just me letting go as an act of higher consciousness. No. As a leader, I had become increasingly aware that we needed to aggregate the maximum amount of collective creativity we could muster to fully prosper amid an increasingly competitive commercial environment. As I say, context is everything. Walking into the retreat meeting room that brisk February morning, I had come to realize that I was ready to not only accept a strategic plan, but, more importantly, embrace it and help move us forward in creating it together. To contribute to the plan, but not try to direct it myself. And, the toughest challenge, to not micromanage its implementation when I got impatient or itchy for personal creative stimulation. I began the opening session with the story about that fateful road trip with my old friend and the dashboard fuel light. It was designed as an icebreaker to set the tone and let people know a significant change would be taking place across Dogfish Head. We would still need a couple of years to flesh out a holistic company-wide plan, but that day, the plan for the plan was hatched. Out of that retreat would come the beginnings of a strong business plan for our main brewery business, one produced by the whole leadership team and not just me, which was a first for Dogfish Head. The cornerstone of writing that plan was formal sessions addressing Dogfish Head's strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. SWOT. I originally encountered SWOT while on the board of the Brewers Association, which uses this methodology to create its two-year plans. Simply put, the SWOT process helps an organization identify factors that are favorable and unfavorable to achieving its objectives. Step one was to clarify objectives. Instead of using conventional corporate metrics like growth or profit, we chose to focus on our company's ideals. We brainstormed about the things Dogfish Head embodied, the qualities we thought made the product successful and the company special. One by one, a list accumulated on the whiteboard. Goodness, authenticity, valuable differentiation, respect, independence, and competitive. At the top of our list of strengths were such things as brand equity, off-centered, innovative, quality, and our speed in developing products and projects. In retrospect, I think the most important item on the list was our people. Right asses in most seats was the exact phrase. The biggest gap in the org chart at that time was a director of marketing. The company had reached the size where Mariah and I couldn't do it alone anymore. We needed a full-time marketer. We also were on the lookout for a strong operations leader to add to our team. Hiring is perhaps the toughest and most exacting thing we do at Dogfish Head, so getting those right asses in the right seats is no small accomplishment. We take executive recruitment very seriously, which perhaps explains why we are so painfully slow at it. Personal fit is particularly important to us, given the unique culture of the company. But we also need to be confident that the candidate and family will be comfortable living in small-town rural Delaware. In the interviewing process, we use a shorthand phrase to summarize if the potential coworkers will be able to contribute positively to the company we want to be. When we think a person is a fit, we say, "She gets it." Having it at Dogfish is a two-way street. Ours is a unique culture that simply doesn't work for some folks. There are lots of super talented, motivated people who would be more successful in a different environment. We've never officially defined it, but here's my take. People who get it are generally nice, talented, and hardworking. They use their powers for good. I'm reminded of Google's corporate motto, "Don't be evil." As I tell my children again and again, they're probably sick of hearing it, I believe we all have different superpowers, but we all share the ability to use our unique powers for good or for evil. And the best teams of superheroes are those that have complementary powers that they use to do the right things in every instance where a choice can be made, from obeying a stop sign to saying thank you when someone does something nice, to making choices that benefit others instead of yourself. We are not saints at Dogfish Head, but as a culture, we strive to opt for the choices most filled with goodness. When we consider candidates for hire, we are looking for people with the humility to know they must first learn why we do things the way we do before they try to use the skills and experience they have to make Dogfish better. We want them to devote their talents to improving the company. We are open to ideas from anyone. But we expect newcomers to first bend toward Dogfish before they ask Dogfish to bend toward them. As Nick often says, we don't want new people coming in and waving the wand of change before they even fully get Dogfish. We also want people who love people, even though this sounds like a cheesy yacht rock lyric. Some corporate cultures thrive on internal competition. Think of Jack Welch's General Electric. But not us. Our objective is to grow a great company, which takes fewer rock stars and more band members. Being a good person doesn't mean playing only support roles. The company needs its brightest and its best to be internal leaders. Getting it means you understand that at Dogfish, you don't advance by stepping on your coworkers, but rather by helping them and the company as a whole move forward. I, myself, had to get better at humility, despite my unique position at Dogfish of being not just the majority owner, but also the face and analog voice of the company. Mariah is the digital voice through social media, which she does really well. After 20 years in the small but growing craft beer community, I'm a well-known figure because I have been involved with some high-visibility projects and because of my role in conceiving most of our high-profile beers. This fills me with mixed feelings. On the one hand, being recognizable affords real benefits to me and the company. This is particularly true if either, or both, of my children eventually chooses to work at Dogfish. There will be continuity when this family-controlled and family-led company transitions from first to second-generation leadership. In our emerging collaborative management model, however, my coworkers need to see me as one of many creative voices, not the sole creative voice. Internally and externally, we have a culture of sharing due credit with our coworkers and celebrating their achievements. When somebody stops me on the street or calls out to me at an event to say, "I love your beer," or "I love Dogfish," I always try to say something like, "On behalf of the 230 of us, I thank you for the kind words and support." In thanking a fan, I am also actively and honestly thanking my coworkers for their contributions. It may sound forced or folksy, but it comes from the heart. A big part of my job description will continue to be saying thank you for your support to our customers, retailers, and distributors, and taking the time to hear from them on what they would like to see more of from Dogfish Head. The weakness quadrant in the SWOT matrix confirmed my conviction that Dogfish Head had hit a point of inflection. The list of what we needed to fix was a collective plea for more orderly stability. Here are some of the weak points we shared in this quadrant. Too short-term oriented. Entire management must find equilibrium. Too many ideas and not enough resources to maintain. Operational accountability and systems. Scheduling. As I stared at this list, I had to admit to myself nearly all of our weaknesses stemmed from a lack of planning, a lack of communication, and a lack of follow-through. All issues that could be addressed in a multi-year strategic plan. I was fully converted. I stopped regarding a strategic plan as a betrayal of conscience and started thinking of it as a roadmap for opportunity. If Dogfish Head were going to continue to be bold, it was imperative that all of us, including me, move in the same direction. Our energies and resources had to be better marshaled if we were to seize forthcoming opportunities and overcome challenges. To fail to do so, I now knew, meant that a whole lot of faithful, talented people might end up going over a cliff at my personal behest. With the help of other leaders at our company, the entrepreneur was becoming a better leader. Interview. Nick Benz, CEO Dogfish Head. Nick Benz is one of the most astute financial and operational-minded business people I've ever met. He received a degree in chemical engineering, then went on to earn his MBA. His career arc at Dogfish from CFO to COO to CEO speaks for itself in terms of his capabilities. But what his resume doesn't show is how he has grown personally over that period. Along with his business acumen, his sense of humor, honesty, and deep understanding about what makes Dogfish Head stand apart from traditional business models are what have made him so integral to the leadership of our company. What distinguishes the Dogfish way? Sam. First question, Nick. Which skill honed through your engineering background has proven to be the most valuable to your career path and your contributions to Dogfish Head? Nick. I don't think I've ever answered that before. It is probably problem solving. That is what engineers really train to do in those 4 years, is to solve problems and look at things in three ways. What do you have at your disposal? What is given? What are you trying to find? And what is the solution? You have to understand what you are working with, the given, what you are searching for, and how you put that all together to find a solution. You can take large, complex things and find a way, find a commonality, and find the core uniting things that make them all link together and work in harmony. In that regard, a brewery is just one giant conundrum where you are figuring out pumps, compressors, tanks, pipes, and control systems. It is similar to a gas or a chemical plant. When you are trying to solve problems that are related to people, or money, or banking relationships, or sales trends, although there is not a mechanical solution involved, the approach is exactly the same. You start by identifying what you know. You start with a list of what is working. That ultimately leads to questions. At the intersection of all the questions you ask about why something is not working is the root cause, the heart of what really is at issue. Once you identify that root cause, you can begin wrapping solutions around that core thing. In the early days, we, you and I, would have to do that. Now there are other people skilled in each area who are doing that. That has been a big transformation for us. Our roles are morphing from the people who come up with the solution at a very detailed level to being the people who oversee the process of continually evolving and continual improvement. That is just a different type of role, a different challenge. Sam, it is inspiring and managing people. Nick, it is inspiring and managing people. We are not managing numbers, brands, consumers, and decision-making anymore. We are managing people who manage all those things. That is where you go from being a manager to being a leader. We cannot be in those trenches anymore, even though that may be where it is more fun, and that may be what was familiar for so long while Dogfish was still a small entrepreneurial company. It is just not that way anymore. Sam, you went back to school and received an MBA after you had worked as an engineer for a few years. Do you feel like your MBA education prepared you in different ways for Dogfish Head? Nick, engineering as a discipline is very much like mathematics in that at a very young age, you learn basic principles, 1 plus 1 equals 2. Then you start introducing things like variables where X is an unknown. You search for a value for it through formulaic approaches. Then you bring in geometry. The point is you start at this very broad, simple foundation. You start layering on top.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.